I've always been a member of the student union movement in my days at the University of Benin, particularly during the June 12 presidential election, time when the military refused to hand over power to the winner of the election, Chief MK Abiola. So we were actually part of the national student union body that embarked on nationwide demonstration to actualize the June 12 mandate. And then at the same time, we also pushed for the release of Ken Saruwa and the 8 other Ogoni activists who were arrested by the Abacha administration. And somehow, a few days after they were executed, I fled Nigeria and came to the Netherlands, where I asked for political asylum in 1995. And I've been in the Netherlands since then. Well, I've always, by accident somehow, I got to Amsterdam, and I traveled through Kano, and KLM was the only commercial flight that was traveling out of Kano to Europe. And so that was how I got myself into Amsterdam. And then when I got to Amsterdam, I realized that I didn't know that Shell headquarters was actually in The Hague in the Netherlands. So it was when I got there, I now discovered that Shell headquarters was actually in The Hague. And during that period, there had been a lot of accusation on Shell that Shell was actually responsible for the reason why the Ogoni 9 activists were killed by the Abacha administration. So a lot of people were coming to me to ask me questions about the role of Shell in the Niger Delta area, the role of Shell in the killing of Ken Saro-Wiwa. And then from there, I did my bit of research to find out how Shell was also doing their oil operation in the Netherlands. And I discovered that they were operating a double standard. The way they were operating in the Netherlands was far from the way they were operating in the Niger Delta region. So I was motivated to now show to the Dutch people, you know, the environmental atrocities that the oil company was carrying out in the Niger Delta area that was affecting the lives of the people in the area of environment and human rights. So from there, I started making some short documentary films, you know, showcasing situations of oil spills, gas flaring, and how it was affecting the ordinary people, which included myself when I was still in Nigeria at the time. And then from there, I started lobbying government agencies, civil society organizations to see how pressure can be put on the oil company to carry out at least the very minimum international standard that is required in oil extractions, and to also do exactly the same thing that they were doing in the Netherlands and in other European countries, so that they can also do the same in the Niger Delta area. So that was my motivation. Well, it takes, you need concerted effort to be able to achieve results. But one major thing that we've been able to achieve is the awareness that we've raised from the activities that we've carried out. At least to some extent, people now know what the oil company is doing. You know, the Niger Delta is a very remote part of Nigeria where there's no electricity. People hardly access those areas. But through some of the activities that we've carried out, people have now come to see for themselves the reality of the situation on the ground. Like, I have invited many Europeans, even Americans. In 2009, I invited four Americans and one Dutch guy. We were the first people to actually visit the camp of Mende during the militancy era, you know, in Bayelsa State, you know, to cover the area and to also find out why they took arms against the government and against the oil multinational companies. I have also brought Dutch members of parliament, you know, to come and witness gas flaring situation as it affects the communities in those areas. When we visited in 2010, we were actually arrested by the JTF in a community called Obe in Oria of a local government area. But then when they came back to the Netherlands, they were so moved with what they saw that they had to organize a parliamentary hearing in which Shell was summoned to come and explain their role in the Niger Delta. So in that parliamentary hearing, I was invited to also speak. So these are some of the things our advocacy has actually led to, you know, political pressure on the oil company, which I think is necessary for the oil company to set up a proper policy. In most cases, the policies are there, but implementing the policies are the problem. So I always believe that you cannot take advantage of the fact that the government do not have the political clout to be able to carry out the oversight needed to control this oil company as an excuse for you to continue to operate with impunity. So the oil companies should at least follow international standard in their operation, irrespective of the weakness of most of these intervention agencies that are meant to control and regulate their operations. So this is some of the things that I push on the international scale, not just at the Dutch parliament level. We've also done that at the European Union level and also at the United Nations level as well. You see, one of the biggest advantages that I've come to see as a privilege is the fact that I left Nigeria and I came to Europe and I came to the Netherlands, and I've been able to see the difference in how companies operate in the area, the government, the responsibility of government, the responsibility of the corporation, and how they come together to bring benefits to the ordinary people. And that is what is lacking in Nigeria, and most especially the Niger Delta area. You know, I mean, you cannot be the eighth largest exporter of crude oil in the world, and you produce crude oil, and then the people who live in the same environment where this crude oil is being processed are living under the poverty line. Like, for instance, I've been to a community called Ezetu in Bayelsa State. That was even the community where myself and my Dutch colleagues were kidnapped in 2014. Now, in Ezetu community, you have the Bonga oil field, you have the EA oil field, and together, both oil fields produces close to 450,000 barrels of crude oil per day. And you have 12 communities in those areas. As we speak right now, I was there in 2009, and I was there again in 2014. The people do not have schools, they do not have electricity, they drink from terrible water condition. Yes. What I did was, when I went there in 2009, I saw the state of the community, and I saw the water they were drinking from, you know. And then we did a short documentary on that, which we threw on the social, on the public platform and on YouTube. And then in 2014, we went to the same community, same well where these people are drinking from. Nothing had changed. I mean, it is completely unacceptable. I can understand that, you know, the government has its responsibility to take care of the people. But I should also expect the company, under corporate social responsibility, to be able to at least do something or push the government to do something, because you cannot continue to operate in an area for more than 50 years and you don't have good relationship with the people, because the people are living very poor, in a very poor condition. They've all been neglected. And so those are the things that actually push me to take the case of the community people, you know, to the highest, both regional and international level. Last year, I was at the 9th session of the United Nations minority issues, where I put forward the case of the Ogoni people, you know, before the United Nations. And so, because I believe that those agents, those organizations have a bigger role to play. One of the challenges I face, which I believe a lot of Nigerians face in diaspora, is the issue of credibility. You know, unfortunately, Nigeria as a country has been known for fraudulent activities, has been known for all sort of, you know, fraud-related, you know, crime and all of that. So, as a Nigerian, one of the challenges I faced at the beginning was, whenever I go to organizations, individuals, and people, the first thing they remember or they remind me of is how they watched on TV a few days ago of two Nigerians scamming one white guy, is how some Nigerians were caught with drugs, is how they, you know, these are crimes that every country commits, whether Americans, whether Europeans. There are a lot of Dutch people sitting in international jails today for crimes relating to drugs. So those crimes are not peculiar with Nigerians alone. But unfortunately, you know, that of Nigeria has overshadowed the good work that some Nigerians are actually doing. So in order to break that barrier, I needed to do more. I needed to, if I go to meetings, I carry my briefcase, I carry my phones, I come with evidence. I come with things to show that I am not what you think. And then I have to push my boundaries very, very well to be able to show that I am transparent. And sometimes I have to even arrange meetings at my residence just to let the people feel that, well, if he can do this meeting in his house with his wife, with his children, then of course it's not running anywhere. So those were the things I had to do which were not normal in order to prove. And right now I have that credibility, I have that legitimacy. Now, there are a lot of things that I would have been able to do. There are a lot of opportunities that have come to me as an individual from companies, from civil society organizations that, oh, Sunny, listen, if you do it like this, if you do it like that, if you take it to the Niger Delta, we will be able to do it like this, do it like that, and then people will benefit. But those things cannot function without the government involvement, because most of these organizations just need the government to give assurance, provide security, you know. And then you now bring those proposals, and then you now start to go through those bureaucracy of, you know, the person wanting his interest, the person not liking you as a person, or the person, you know, you're coming for the good of the people through a government person, and then you are being kept in his office, you know, waiting for 4 hours. He's acting as if he's the one helping you, whereas you're the one helping. So if we take that out, and if I have a platform that gives me the power to be able to implement policy, which means government today, I think we will be able to do more. And what I find very, very disturbing also in our politics is the fact that most of our government, or rather, most of our leaders, all they know is to wait for federal allocation, wait for internally generated revenues, wait for all this money that comes from here and there, here and there. They just sit down and wait. So when the money comes and the money is not enough to run the state of affairs, then they start to owe. Government should be run like a private business where you use what you get and then you look outside to see the opportunities that you can create, you know, that can benefit your people outside of the allocation that comes to you. Of course, if I was not optimistic about it, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. If I was not optimistic about Nigeria taking their rightful position in global economy, I would not be doing what I'm doing. I'm very proud of Nigeria. Anywhere I go, I always carry the logo with me. I am proud to speak about the human capacity that we have, the determination that every Nigerian carries. And I'm happy that some few white people who have been to Nigeria before, they testify to that same claim that Nigerians are very happy even in the midst of their adversity. I mean, I've seen young guys who are very creative in ideas with all the hindrances, with all the challenges, you know, they are doing very well and they are putting Nigeria at the rightful position. Where we have not gotten it right is leadership. Once we get it right on leadership, Nigeria will take its rightful place in global affairs. And I am hoping and believing that that will not be in the near future. It will happen in our time.